with the title, and so the title is Silicon Quantum Dots, Physics and Emerging Applications. And this has been a subject that has been going around for some time, like 30 years now, since 1990. What I show on my first slide here. So here are some individual dots that we have caught on a movie. On the lower right, we have done single dot spectroscopy. These are different shot peaks from individual silicon quantum dots. And up to the right, we have loaded them into some polymers. So I hope you see the same screen as I do. So these are the number of people contributing to this work. And these are at KTH, in particular, Associate Professor Ilya Sushugo. And there are also some alumni, some previous PhD students. We have also had a collaboration with the John Daniels group and with the group of John Valenta in Prague, and then with some theoreticians, Juve Lu and Alex Sumer. My outline of this presentation is simply an introduction. Physics, the early findings, and what kind of light can we shed on these early findings by single dot spectroscopy? And then some nice emerging applications. So let's start. So quantum dots, this was discovered sort of in the 1980s, 1990s, and when nanocrystals could be made in biochemical synthesis, and these are examples of CDSC nanocrystals in toluene. And there's a quantum size effect, which is predicted by quantum mechanics. So the smaller the nanocrystals, the more blue the emission. And this can also be seen in absorption. And then in 1990, porous silicon was discovered by Lee Canham in Great Britain. So what you see here is he has a wafer that he silicon wafer that he has etched porous, and he has a UV lamp to excite these porous structures, and outcomes orange light. These are spectra he took, and here is an EM image showing that it's really a structured silicon that is left after the etching. Here's a wafer we made. And behind you can see cadmium selenide nanocrystals. What you see here is that these are all excited by the same UV lamp. And remarkably, they have almost the same luminescence intensity. So it's kind of strong light here, what was observed. Now the silicon, porous silicon is one type, but you can also make silicon nanocrystals by other techniques. And so this is the EM image by the Hofmeister Wiesen group many years back, which is a pretty large one, probably infrared luminescence. And then of course you can have different kinds of surface passivations, which surely has an effect on the emission and how they work. So just for fun, I looked at the number of publications. I searched for porous silicon, just like that, in the citation index. And you see here, there's a huge increase in the beginning here, around 1990 after that. It was really like a boom, like the gallium nitride became to be, or other types in this. If one searches for silicon nanocrystals, they come up a little later in time, but many times people were working on those instead because they were sort of more stable. And now I also search for silicon quantum dots, and they come up very lately here, and they are sort of stabilizing here. And then we come to one of the new applications, like qubits. So how can this occur then, the light emission? Because, as you know, one never uses, so far, silicon for making LEDs. It's always direct band gap materials. And for indirect band, because silicon has an indirect band gap, so in principle, a photon is needed to convert the the wave vector here. Thus, this emission process is much less likely. It does, however, have a direct band gap here at around 3.2 electron volts at the gamma point. So, when this was observed, there was a lot of open questions. So there was a lot of discussion. So is the light really coming from quantum confined excitons, or does it come from some surface species like siloxene? The spectral tuning, can one really go from, can it be tuned by the size effects and how far? The broad spectra that Canham showed, is it because there is a lot of size distribution, so that if you could have a uniform size, you will get sharp lines? Yes, the direct band gap, is it like that? The quantum efficiency, how high can it be? The porous structures were rather bright, but they had like 5 to 10% quantum efficiency at that time. High excitations, is that possible? Could you have optical gain, which would be the fundamentals of a laser device? But one of the main challenges then was that the radiated lifetime was pretty long, so it was in the microsecond range, whereas direct band gap materials were in the nanosecond range. So that purely indicated that the physical mechanism was slightly different, or largely different, maybe. So let's look at the early findings. Here's a paper published by Koshida in 96, and indeed he etched porous silicon at the different times, and he could show that the luminescence could be tuned, although intensity is lower here, and there was a similar lifetime, which all indicated that there is a similar mechanism underlying here, the different emission wavelengths. And here is some different colors. Yes, and then came paper by Kovalev. He was exciting resonantly. So here's the material he was studying, porous silicon, had a luminescence about 1.55 electron volts. And then he excited close to that. And what he saw then, that there was a step here when you had a TU difference here. And all that pointed out that yes, indeed, phonons must be present here, and that's the underlying mechanism for the emission. Then there was observed also that although you had a very the absorption could be tuned by reducing the size, the PL emission was largely into the red, and that could partly be explained by experiment by Wolfin and Fauchery in 1998, where they show that when porous silicon had just been etched, one could see a blue-green emission, but that quickly turned into the reddish colors, presumably by oxidation. And it was postulated then that this is probably the light emission comes from defect in the shell, the oxide shell, like oxygen double bond. There was also a famous experiment by Mayer, Petrov and Koch, where they show that as the prepared porous silicon had hydrogen atoms for passivation at higher temperatures, they went away and the luminescence then vanished and it came back by oxidation. And this was because of a high spin density and then which resulted in the quenching of the luminescence. Then came the paper of Pavesi's group showing optical gain in silicon non-crystals. So that was fantastic. And we were all very astonished. And from their experiments, they could deduce that they got an optical gain, which was in this region here, which could well be used for making a silicon laser then at the time. Unfortunately, these experiments could never be repeated really. And there was a lot of discussion and no consensus from this, these findings at that time. But we were very much interested in that, in the mechanism for the light emission. And since we had a very good clean room laboratory and we had access to electron beam lithography, so we started out, let's try to do very small silicon nanostructure objects. And here's an example where we have pillars of silicon. And the nice thing about silicon is that you can oxidize it, so the core then is shrinking. And you can repeat that several times. And maybe at the end, you will have a quantum dot at the top here. So what we did was simply, we did the structure oxidized. We went into the photoluminescence lab and looked if there was any luminescence. If not, we would proceed with another oxidation. We tried pillars, we tried walls, and indeed they worked the same. Here's an example of the pillar. This is before the last oxidation, let's say. So this one would not be luminescent. And finally, we also tried planes, 2D quantum wells. And so we made very thin silicon layers. We simply etched away most of the silicon on an SOI wafer. And by accident, then we could see some luminescence here. And here's the dot which with the Sushugo actually could see in by TM. Here's our luminescence setup, the spectroscopy setup. So it consists, here's the sample, it's an inverted microscope, and light goes out to a spectrometer. We have different laser excitation. We have APD also here, which is good for the silicon luminescence. The lab, it looks like this. So here's the inverted microscope. Here's the spectrometer and and/or ICCC camera. And on the side here is the, this is the photon count. So in the beginning, so here's a sample with lines, and by accident, by random process, you get some quantum dots. And one can see that they each have different luminescence spectra, but quite broad ones. So this was in 2002. Later on, we could go down in temperature. We had it in the cryostat. We optimized things, and then we could really get sharp spectra. So this is what we think is a no phono lines. This is a TO phono. And actually, when we look at several of these spectra, one can see that most of this line comes at about 60, where it's expected for the silicon TO line. There are some other peaks as well. This could presumably be a stretching mode of the nanocrystal. Here are some spectra then from different dots. And you see we can cover a large spectrum. And here's the overlap with the with a room temperature photoluminescence from an ensemble of porous silicon or whatever. Here's also one of the sharpest, and this is limited actually by spectral resolution. This is almost at what been seen then, but the sharpest is what has been seen for rectangular mechanics. And how can we treat this? show everything. Well, what we typically see, what we can see is that the no phonon line is dominating and the TO phonon line is only small here. And the way to explain this is that this is a quasi-direct transition. And indeed, for small structures, the Heisenberg uncertainty principle says that the uncertainty in a wave vector will become large. And so you will have states that look like this. And presumably the transition goes then direct to from the edges of these states like that. And that could be then that could also explain that this was observed in these measurements, but not always. So some of them probably have the TO phonon lines, others have only the direct transition. Here's some theoretical calculations by a group of Sumer, June, and June Bailu. And here are the valence states of silicon quantum dots, and here are the conduction states. And you see S-like, P-like, P-like, and so on. And then the various transitions that can occur here. And they calculate a spectra like that. And this is for a 2-nanometer nanocrystal. And obviously this is the lowest here is the PL emission line. So what we did was we looked at absorption, and for a silicon nanocrystal, for a single quantum dot that we could observe, we measured the spectrum then at low temperature, was rather sharp as you see here, and then we measured this line by PLE. So we tuned the excitation wavelength simply by filtering a lamp, and then we could see that there was some bumps like this, which could be explained then by these peaks. And when we look at the previous calculated spectra, we could say that yes, this is probably this line, the emission line. We don't see several dose, but here it's a sizable absorption. This is explained this line, the next line is by these transitions. Another effect of quantum dot is that you often see blinking. Okay, it doesn't excite the least, but you saw it on the first my first slide. So for cadmium selenide, we compared measurements like that, and for silicon, you also can have blinking between two intensity states, from a dark to a luminescent state. We did statistics on that, and got this. This is the probability density then for different interval lengths, and in some way it resembles. But you see here we have a linear scale indicating that this is an exponentially diminishing statistics in our case, while for the cadmium selenide they have a power law statistic. So the blinking is believed that that once in a while an exciton or the electron goes into a trap state, and then when you excite the next exciton, you have three particles here and you get the instant Auger recombination, and so the nanocrystal becomes dark. And eventually the electron comes back here, or it disappears, and you're back to normal luminescent state. Then we looked at non-radiative recombination. So I'll go through these slides very quickly. And what we measured on single dots was that different dots had different lifetimes. And when you plot this here, there is no resemblance of the photon energy. So they are all very short, and this is probably set by non-radiative channels at the same time. And when one put this together, all this, one actually see this stretch exponential that is observed for silicon. And one of the models we had in mind then was that, again, I cannot exploit this my laser pointer here. So this should be a blinking movie. And when you take the average of that, you sum all images, you find that the different dots have different intensities, and this is largely due to this non-radiative recombination. But we postulated that maybe this can be due to super blinking, so blinking that occurs on a very short time scale that we are not able to observe. And why do we assume that? Well, in that case, we don't have to invoke some kind of strange non-radiative center, which has never been really shown for this. And we can simply explain it in a very simple phenomenon, and that is blinking. And indeed, it's known that oxides, so these nanocrystals are covered by oxide, they have trap states. And that's a very simple explanation for the blinking phenomenon. I think I'll skip this now in order to keep up the time. I don't have exactly. One of the things we were trying to look for was by excitons. So if one pumps sharp high, so in most nanocrystals, one see a by exciton line build up here. So this is for indium phosphide. In silicon, we pumped harder and harder, but we could not really observe it because probably the intensity is very low, or it's at the same site, in the same position as the normal luminescence. But when we looked at the lifetime, we could, if we pumped harder, we could really see a short tail here indicating that there must be a by-exit time. We could get the by-exit lifetime here. Let's come to emerging applications. Yes. So, as I showed you in the beginning, I mean, there was a lot of hype and many were interested in porous silicon when it came, but the feeling is now that the community has diminished quite a lot, and this is just a time when the interesting applications are emerging, actually. So one of the things that has happened is that one can make silicon nanocrystals in a much more efficient way, and this was predicted by the group of pioneered by the group of Veynaud in Canada. One takes this compound, hydrogen synthesis QXN, HSQ, which has an excess of silicon compared to silicon dioxide. And then one has a simple high temperature anneal, like 1100 centigrade, and the nanocrystals precipitate out. You take away the oxide by an HF etch, and then you get the nanocrystals in the solution like this. And this is shown down here in some vials. Then after that, you can passivate it, and yes. So here are some measurements that we did on such samples from nanocrystals, I believe from Chisinau at the time. This is our quantum yield measurement setup. And indeed, we could have rather high quantum yields, up to 60% for the best. Then you can also put the nanocrystals into a polymer. And here shows these polymers under room light, and here is under UV excitation. And it turns out that also these polymers, they have very good stability, first of all, but also quantum efficiency can be high, approaching 50% sometimes. So Ilya Sushugo in our group then proceeded with different precursors, and we tried silicon monoxide also, and triethoxyacylane. All of these precursors can be made into silicon nanocrystals. And here are measurements with different sizes. So one of the applications then that has been that has come up is solar concentrators. So if you load these nanocrystals into a window, let's say in a polymer film, onto a glass window, you could potentially harvest some of the sunlight that will give you excitations, and the red or infrared luminescence will be wave-guided to the sides of this layer. And then you can harvest it by normal PV cells like that. And indeed, this is a sample that we made in our lab, and you see one can see through it, so it's transparent. The nanocrystals excite, and they deliver a lot of luminescence then to the edges of this sample. And they, the group of Ilya Sushugo then has continued, and they had made large sizes like that. The biggest windows here are like 20 by 20 centimeters. And they can harvest them by ordinary solar cells, then the light here, the energy on the side. And here's an example. Let me see. No. Something with the pointer here. So I cannot excite this film, this movie, unfortunately.
If you click on the pointer again, usually it vanishes, and then you have access to click on the, if you click on the laser pointer,
okay.
If you go on the menu, and now the uppermost, exactly, and then you should be
able to start. Thanks very much. Thank you. So this is one of these samples, and you can see that there are ordinary solar cells below and on the edges here, and there are a couple of electrical lines here. And this is a simple little toy that is pumping here when it gets power. And from this window, apparently the peak electrical power is half a watt. The total convergent efficiency here can be like 1 or 2% maybe. Here's another application where we put quantum dots into transparent wood. This is a separate project going on here at our university. And here it's loaded with cadmium selenide nanocrystals. Here it's loaded with silicon nanocrystals. Let's move on in the applications. And just 2020, I happened to see that in a journal that I not read very much, there was a publication about an all-silicon distributed feedback laser with a wide gain range. So apparently, that confirms the old observations of optical gain by the Pavese group. And you can see here a gain spectrum in this emission wavelength range. The trick here, what they did was that they used very high pressure hydrogen anneal for a very long time, and apparently that passivates structure very well, the quantum yield of these nanocrystals were over 50%, which is probably necessary to have net gain. And another applications which is coming up is CMOS silicon spin qubit, and that is based on quantum dots that you make in a MOS structure, and by having them very close, they can sort of transfer information between the two. And what you're looking at here, you define a quantum dot and you inject a single electron into that. And you have a specific spin then, and the spins will sort of talk to each other. So this is by the group in Grenoble here, by Silvano De Franceschi. But there are many actually groups now working on this. And the lifetimes, I think they can come up to what the word now, but you can have like microseconds remembrance of the spin state here. So coming to conclusions, so one of the effects of the silicon quantum dot, the high yield, is of course that you have compared to bulk silicon, you're shielding carriers from defects, and one of them becomes a small light emitter. Some are dark, of course. And then another is what I talked about, the quasi-direct recombination, which then results in a very long lifetime, nevertheless, in a quasi-direct transition. We try to answer these questions that were put in the beginning. So yes, what I've mostly focused on here is quantum confined luminescence, but of course there are many that also have other surface molecules that emit. And particularly, this is true for the blue and green emitting nanocrystals. Spectral tuning, yes, possible, but green-blue is very difficult. Probably the luminescence efficiency is low for these colors. I've shown very sharp line widths. The band gap is quasi-direct in most cases. Some authors are claiming direct, but one is wondering then maybe we are then at some surface molecules that emit. It remains to be studied. The quantum efficiency, yes, 100% can probably be reached. Yes, even optical gain should be possible. So this is the funding that we have received during the years. And thank you for your attention. So, any questions on this?
Thank you very much, Professor Lenrons, for a so detailed and excellent presentations. Results. So, you showed to us some experimental and real uncomputed data, yeah?
Yes. Yeah. Mostly, we have experimental data. Yes.
Experiment. Mm. Now, we are waiting for questions from our colleagues from different countries. Please, Professor Fomin is first.
Professor Lindros, thank you very much for your motivating talk, and I have one question related to the very early stages of colloidal quantum dots. First investigations showed extremely high phonon-related features in them, so that if you consider, for example, photoluminescence or Raman scattering, then phonon sidebands were sometimes one or two orders of magnitude higher than zero phonon line. And then this was explained by non-adiabaticity of exciton phonon system in those dots. Then it was extended also to other dots. I wonder whether there were some interesting developments in your field where the phonons would be related, and not only in negative sense, but also as factors which can increase the useful output of those quantum dots. Thank you.
Okay. I mean the what I indicated in the direct transitions, they are sort of competing with the phonon transitions. So that's why you see them in certain dots and maybe not in other dots. So that is why the direct transitions are less or very sort of unlikely. And that results in the very long lifetimes that you observe for these quantum dots. But one cannot say, I mean, so in the beginning, actually, when we looked at individual silicon nanocrystals and the emission spectrum, we looked for the TO phonons all the time, and we took away. But finally, we had to accept that some of them, and most of them, in fact, had direct lines. And then we could see that we indeed have this sometimes the TO phonon also showed up. So there's a competition between these mechanisms.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor. Next, please, Professor Adjalung, please.
Thank you for the very nice talk. I was wondering, you showed nicely that you can tune the adsorption, and in this way you get quite precise colors from all over the optical spectra. We are working with our arrow materials also on the scattering of light. So if you shoot in, for example, with a laser, then this laser gets inside of this arrow material completely scattered, so that it loses the coherence, and you have no speckle pattern at the end. What would be an interesting application is coming with three color lasers in order to get white light out of it. However, one part is missing, I think. This is some quantum dots we would like to throw in order to have a little bit broadening of the laser wavelengths in order to get a nicer white light in this sense, and avoid that the eye gets too much of an intensity with a small bandwidth. Even though it looks white, it's still then perfectly only the laser wavelengths. Do you think that this silicon nanocrystals can be used, quantum dots can be used for such applications? Is it possible to fabricate them for certain wavelengths? And
well, one could fabricate them mostly for the red light emission, so they would have broad spectrum. But if you want to have all over the visible range, I would go for cadmium selenide, okay, or indium phosphide nanocrystals. Indium phosphide is more is less toxic, and you can buy them right away from big chemical companies.
A pure silicon would have been also, of course, nice. Then, you do not have to mess around with any chemicals. Okay.
Yes. Absolutely. Mm-hmm. Yes. Yeah.
Thank you very much. More questions, please.
Can I ask a short question?
Yes, Professor Timoshenko.
Professor Linar, thank you very much.
I cannot hear you.
So,
is something wrong with your microphone?
Related to the lifetime of single dots at low temperature. Did you measure lifetime of single dots at low temperature? Microphone is working.
Okay. Yes.
Could you?
Sure. Okay. We did.
Do you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you now. Hello. Yes. Yeah.
Hello.
Aha, you cannot hear me or?
The question about lifetime.
Yeah.
My question about lifetime.
We measured
single dots.
Yes, we measured at low temperatures as well, and as far as I remember, the lifetime increased slightly, but not so much actually.
It's a little bit in contrast to the lifetime measurement for porous silicon, where lifetime changed a big range with decrease of temperature.
Right. Yes, but this is from single dots. So so the what you see in porous silicon, and that's an average of many dots. So
thank you for your answer.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
In my talk, I combine two kind of nanomaterials, semiconductor, mainly silicon, and plasmonic nanoparticles. Why it is combined in one talk? Because both type of nanomaterials allow us to use them in as called theranostics. Theranostic is well-known idea for novel biomedical technology, which is based on combination, simultaneous combination, at the same time, the same agent, both the diagnostics and therapy. And of course, both type of nanomaterials, semiconductor, mainly silicon nanoparticles, nanocrystals, and plasmonic nanoparticles are very attractive with this point of view. And I will try to demonstrate in my talk how silicon and another type, of course, semiconductor nanoparticles can be used in such medical approach. Let's start with silicon. Professor Linus already explained how very nice luminescent silicon quantum dots can be prepared and investigated. But I will speak not only about luminescent, but also about non-luminescent silicon nanoparticles. Silicon nanoparticles is very broad range. In that case, we are speaking about quantum dots, and also they can be very large, like balls with dimensions about hundreds nanometers, and also them can be like wires. Also, silicon nanoparticles can be formed by a lot of methods. For example, they can be prepared from plant waste, for example, rice husk. Of course, the main features advantage of silicon nanomaterials, which influence, of course, on their properties. Toxic, by the way, as many type of plasmonic materials based on gold. And for this reason, it is very suitable for application in biomedicine. As for theranostic approach, in case of silicon, if you will add silicon as the main agent, in such approach, we will obtain what's called silicon nanotheranostics and multifunctionality of silicon nanoparticles, which can be act like label in luminescence imaging. And Professor Linus already shown that such imaging can be very nice, very bright. Also, they can be used as potential contrast agent in magnetic resonance imaging, which is full body imaging. Of course, efficiency is still to be improved. And another important part of their properties is their synthesizes properties for mild therapy of cancer by using photoexcitation, ultrasound excitation, and thermal, photothermal, for example, therapy. Also, porous silicon nanoparticles can be used as nanocarriers for drugs and radionuclides. In my talk, I will speak only about two modality related to photoexcitation, but I want to remind activation silicon-based nanoparticles, because this approach is universal. It can be also used for gold nanoparticles, for any small nanoparticles, solid nanoparticles dispersed in liquids or biosystems. Here you see some figures from it, two types of silicon-based nanomaterials prepared from port by laser ablation of solid targets in liquid. In that case, silicon nanoparticles are polycrystalline, with mean size about 10 nanometers. They are nearly spherical in contrast to porous silicon nanoparticles. But mean size of such silicon ball-like nanoparticles is really very small in comparison to porous silicon nanoparticles, which can be prepared, for example, by mechanical grinding of porous silicon films. What is interesting, under irradiation of such nanoparticles dispersed in water or biological liquids, they exhibit strong heating under irradiation with radio frequency waves, which is not absorbed in pure water. Here you see example of temperature growth transients for porous silicon nanoparticles with rate heating rate about 11 degrees per minute, and for laser ablated nanoparticles. For lower concentration of ablated nanoparticles, we have comparable heating rate. And this effect was explained heating mechanism related to the Joule current around the surface area, the larger contribution of the same weight concentration of nanoparticles in comparison to the larger nanoparticles. And this effect can be used, for example, in hyperthermia destruction of cancer tumor. Here you see a schematic view of the. I discussed that silicon nanoparticles with certain amount on dendritic bonds, exactly the same dendritic bonds, which can quench the photoluminescence. This dendritic bond, specially designed dendritic bonds with high density, can allow us to use silicon nanoparticles as contrast agent for MRI imaging. Here you see example how rate of proton relaxation aqueous solutions depend on the concentration of silicon nanoparticles with high amount of dendritic bonds. But in next part of my talk, I will speak mostly about photo properties of silicon nanoparticles. Silicon nanoparticles were prepared by two main methods. The first method is traditional methods of porous silicon formation combined with detaching of porous silicon films, the grinding in water in planetary mill, the strategy which was proposed many years ago by Lee Kenham. And finally, we observed concentrated aqueous suspension of porous silicon nanoparticles, which consists of a lot of different particles. Here you see example of microporous particles, which are already colored. They are, by the way, luminescent. We can find in this powder very big particles, aggregate of nanocrystals, and also individual nanocrystals with nearly perfect crystalline lattice. These nanocrystals are luminescent. Here you see example of bioimaging, photoluminescence bioimaging, where nanoparticles introduced in cell cultures, cultivated for several times, and then illuminated. And here you see nanoparticles as bright red, yellow spots in the cytoplasm of cells, and nuclei of cells are colored with blue. And for different type of nanoparticles, for microporous particles, we obtain nearly complete coloring of cytoplasm. For nanoparticles prepared from silicon nanowires, we observed individual right spots related to nanowires with luminescent core, luminescent shell. And for dextran coated porous silicon nanoparticles, we observed individual particles because they are well separated. And also by using Z-scan confocal imaging, we was able to recognize localization of such nanoparticles, and they are localized mainly in cytoplasm. There is no nanoparticles inside of nuclei, and most of them are localized inside of cytoplasm. For non-luminescent nanoparticles, one can use Raman spectroscopy in order to detect their presence in the cells and the tissue. Here you see example of Raman spectroscopy of two types of nanoparticles with bright luminescence, this red curve. These nanoparticles were prepared from porous silicon nanowires detached from the surface of silicon wafers. Also, some part of nanoparticles is gray line in the luminescence spectra displayed on the left side. We are not luminescence, and we were able to absorb the localization inside of cells by using Raman mapping, Raman imaging. Here you see Raman images of nanoparticles, and on the left side, there is transmission optical imaging. Also, nanoparticles can be distinguished by using Raman spectroscopy because Raman spectra of silicon is very specific with a very sharp line in the certain wavelength near the certain wave number, near 520 wave numbers. Also, due to degradation and dissolution of nanoparticles in water, this line becomes weaker with time, and we can observe the biodegradation inside of living cells. Besides of porous silicon nanoparticles, one can prepare nanoparticles by using laser-assisted method. For example, laser ablation in inert gas atmosphere, for example, low-pressure helium. And for also, nanoparticles can be produced by direct laser ablation in liquids. When solid silicon targets are used as initial material. Here you see example of preparation luminescent silicon nanoparticles by laser ablation in liquid, laser beam, and usually nanosecond excimer laser is used. Silicon target is evaporating in low pressure helium atmosphere, and after cooling down the evaporated vapors of silicon atoms, they create nanocrystals, nanoparticles, which are collected on the substrate. This is a really porous substrate. It can be easily destroyed, disassembled in ultrasound bath. And finally, we observe some colloid of silicon nanoparticles, which are composed from small silicon nanocrystals. We investigate the size of these nanocrystals, the luminescent properties. Here you see example of luminescent spectra of two types of particles. As prepared, is red curve, and after storage of these nanoparticles in water, the storage resulted in formation additional band in green, violet range, and small shift of the main excitonic band in near-infrared visible spectral range. These two bands were also distinguished by the luminescent lifetime. For the high energy defect-related band, the luminescence lifetime was very short, about 10 nanoseconds, as here you see luminescent transient. And for intrinsic luminescent infrared band, we observed typical for silicon nanocrystals, for exciton and silicon nanocrystals, transients with lifetime about 10 microseconds. These nanoparticles were relatively stable in water because they already were highly oxidized. They can be safe in water for several days with pretty high luminescence. Here you see example of zeta potential measurement of aqueous suspension of such nanoparticles. The zeta potential was rather high, about 30 millielectron volts, and nanoparticles were brightly luminescent after cultivation in cell culture. Here you see these nanoparticles as bright red spot incorporated in cell cytoplasm. For comparison, cell without nanoparticles are shown on the right side image. Okay, because luminescence is efficient only for very small, highly passivated nanoparticles, which is not easy to prepare and save these properties in water, we examined properties of very big nanoparticles formed by laser ablation in water. Their sizes were about 30, mean size is 30, 20 nanometers. also we compare luminescence property of nanoparticles prepared by plasma chemical synthesis, plasma treatment of silane. In that case, also nanoparticles were very large, with typical size about 20 nanometers. They were near monocrystalline, single crystalline, but their sizes were significantly larger than sizes for visible light emission due to quantum size effect. But surprisingly, such nanoparticles under excitation with femtosecond laser pulses with wavelengths in the infrared range, about 780, 910 nanometers in this range, were luminescent, and this luminescence was related to the two-photon absorption, which is enhanced by such size of nanoparticles. Simultaneously, we were able to observe the second harmonic related to the these nanoparticles. You see the spectra, the second harmonic shift, which second harmonic peak with shifts with change of wavelength. But two-photon luminescence band was nearly stable for all wavelength range investigated. And this effect was explained by two-photon absorption, which excite luminescent states in silicon oxide shell, and silicon nanoparticle core act like as enhancer of nonlinearity, optical nonlinearity, and it will increase the efficiency of both second harmonic generation and two-photon absorption. And our experiments with difficult size, mean size of nanoparticles, varied from 5 nanometers to 30 nanometers, revealed that both the second harmonic generation and two-photon absorption related luminescence were stronger when size of nanoparticles increased from 5 to 30 nanometers. And the emission of two-photon excited nanoparticles was observed in mapping experiment. We obtained 2D images. Here you see such images for individual cell cultivated with nanoparticles. The nanoparticle emission is colored in yellow. Second harmonic generation is visible as blue spot, and this efficient second harmonic was typical for aggregate of nanoparticles. And also it was possible to reconstruct the three-dimensional image of cell decorated with such nanoparticles. Therefore, not only small nanoparticles, but even large nanoparticles with certain amount of luminescent state can be used for bioimaging. But besides bioimaging, they can be used in treatment, in phototherapy. Here is an example of application of relatively large nanoparticles with mean sizes about 10 nanometers for photohyperthermia. In that case, suspension of nanoparticles was irradiated with infrared light of semiconductor lasers with wavelengths 808 nanometers, which exactly corresponds to the transparency windows of biological tissue. The mean power of laser was about 3 watt, and the total heating of pure water or biological culture cells was not very strong. But after adding of nanoparticles, which can absorb this light relatively efficient, we can increase the average temperature of the solution in high extent. Here you see a computer simulation for such heating. We observe the heating by using two excitation sources, continuous wave source, and modulated with some frequency with 100 millisecond period in order to increase the maximal heating temperature. And experiments with model cells, with paramecium caudatum cells, demonstrate that this heating was high enough. We were able to heat for several degrees, and it was directly measured. But according to the calculation, because measurement sensitivity was limited by lifetime of thermal imager, but according to our calculations, the heating was about 10 degrees in the maximum of laser pulse. And experimental observation of the effect of laser treatment for a short time, about 10 minutes, resulted in the complete destruction of cell after the pulsed radiation and also continuous wave radiation, resulting in partial destruction of cell. And here you see even optical images of the cell with partially destroyed membrane. It means that really such nanoparticles which did not influence on the cell viability because of low toxicity of nanoparticles can be used as nanoheaters, activator of photoheating, and it is very useful for photohyperthermia of cancer. You know that cancer cells are very sensitive to heating. They are diet at temperature a little bit lower than temperature for death of the normal cells, and this idea of photohyperthermia treatment of cancer. Because of the locality of nanoparticles effect, this can be really spatially and temporarily localized photohyperthermia. And the same effect is well known for plasmonic nanoparticles. There is even technology of gold shell, which can be used for photohyperthermia treatment of cancer. Of course, we did not repeat these experiments. We did a little bit another way. We use aluma silicate halloysite, which is a clay mineral, which is natural material. We deposited gold and silver nanoparticle on the surface of such nanotubes. The length of these nanotubes can be about the hundreds nanometers, about the 1 micrometer, but diameter is relatively small. The maximal outer diameter is about 100 nanometers, and the inner diameter is about 20 nanometers. And this is very good, neutral, again, non-toxic object for demonstration possibility to use plasmonic nanoparticles for both imaging and therapy. Here is the example of nanoparticles of gold. This is upper images, which are distributed in size. It was possible to deposit gold nanoparticles with sizes, the mean sizes varied from 5 nanometers to 10 nanometers with high density. They are well attached to the surface, and they can be used as really stable nanomaterial, nanocomposite for further applications. Here you see modeling, which was done by using finite difference software for nanoparticles exactly with the same distribution which was experimentally found for our nanocomposite materials. For gold nanoparticles, we observed, you see gold nanoparticles as yellow balls on the surface of halloysite nanotubes. And after radiation is light, electric field of light here is shown by red arrow. There is a strong enhancement of the square of electric field, which is proportional to the light intensity, about one order of magnitude. And this effect related to plasmonic enhanced electric field. Also, this effect was observed for another orientation polarization. This effect is, by the way, dependent on the polarization. Of course, the effect was the maximal for wavelengths close to the plasmonic resonance. The same effect, even stronger, was observed in simulation and experiments for halloysite nanotubes with deposited silver nanoparticles, because silver has stronger plasmonic enhancement of electric field. You see this enhancement as red regions nearby nanoparticles. Besides the enhancement near individual nanoparticles, there are hot spots between nanoparticles, and the larger the density of nanoparticles, the larger one enhancement could be achieved. And this modeling was experimentally proved in vitro experiments with model biomolecules. Here you see experiments with dye molecules of rhodamine 6G, where we observe the, it's called CERS effect, surface enhanced Raman scattering for halloysite nanoparticles with deposited nanotubes with deposited silver nanoparticles. And if what is very important, effect was stable for several, up to 7 days storage of such nanocomposite in water. This is a big problem, by the way, for CERS templates, for CERS materials, their stability, especially for the silver. For such nanocomposites, they were very stable for a long time. And this effect was used in order to monitor composition of cells in vitro. Here you see results in the schematic representation when halocyte nanotubes with deposited silver nanoparticles we introduced into cell culture, and first signal from cell membranes, cell proteins was detected. And we observed the enhancement of the signal at certain wavelengths. We use normally red wavelengths for excitation. Of course, it can be improved after adjustment of the wavelengths of photoexcitation and plasmonic wavelengths, but demonstration of possibility to use nanocomposite for in vitro monitoring of cell living cell composition here was provided. And simultaneously for silicon, simultaneously with CERS enhanced signal of biomolecules, we were able, similarly to the silicon nanoparticles, observe to photo hypersthermia treatment. We did experiments with two objects, with bacteria, E. coli, Escherichia coli cells, and with, again, paramecium cells. Here you see example on the upper side, experiments with silver nanoparticles deposited on halocyte nanotube surfaces. After storage for several hours, we observed suppression of E. coli viability. And what is a very important effect was significantly enhanced. You see the comparison between blue and dashed blue bars. In fact, was significantly improved, enhanced after irradiation with light in the plasmonic band. Of course, for individual silver nanoparticles, plasmonic band correspond to the rather short wavelength, about 400 nanometers in aqueous ambient. But for nanoparticles with high density, due to formation of hotspot aggregates of silver nanoparticles, there is a shoulder related to the aggregated nanoparticles, and exactly excitation in this spectral range induces the additional killing of cell related to the photo heating. And this effect was even stronger for cold nanoparticles, which are absolutely chemically inert. And for gold nanoparticles, we observed significant stronger resonance in plasmonic spectral range for gold. Here you see red curve for individual gold nanoparticles, not individual completely, but it was suspension of pure gold nanoparticles. It was aqueous colloidal solution of gold nanoparticles with sizes about 20 nanometers. The plasmonic resonance corresponds to 525 nanometers. This is pure green region. When these nanoparticles are deposited with high density on the surface of halocyte nanotube, there is a small shift and enhancement of the plasmonic resonance because of the hot formation, formation of aggregates with higher electric field enhancement. And here you see again fragment of the simulation of electric field enhancement. And this field enhancement, which also important for the CERS effect, was responsible for additional heating under photoexcitation. Again, similar to the experiments with silicon nanoparticles, we use several laser sources. Was the continuous wave laser radiation with green argon laser line and pulsed laser radiation with nanosecond pulses with high repetition and mean power about the same value, 10 milliwatt. It means that the average heating was the same, but pulsed heating was significantly stronger in case of pulsed excitation. And this effect was directly observed by measuring temperature. Here you see mean temperature. The temperature rose due to radiation. The presence of such a composite material was similar for pulsed and continuous wave radiation. It was about several degrees for 10 minutes of radiation. And despite of such relatively low average heating, the final effect of laser radiation was very strong. You see experiments on the viability of paramecium cells and pulsed radiation, the presence of nanocomposite, resulting complete suppression of cell proliferation. They simply destroyed, they were killed by heating during short laser pulse. And these experiments demonstrate that localization of heating in time and in space using nanoparticles, silver nanoparticles, gold nanoparticles, or silicon nanoparticles is a very efficient way to realize idea of localized hyperthermia for different applications, including antibacterial treatment and thermal therapy of cancer. This is the conclusion of my talk, and also I would like to acknowledge my collaborators for different stages of work in Moscow University, in MIFI, also abroad. Especially my thanks to the Professor Vladimir Fomin, who initiated my participation in this conference, and thank you for your attention.
So many thanks for your very detailed presentation. So please, questions? Yes, Professor.
Professor Timoshenko, thank you very much for this cornucopia of ideas, approaches, ranging from basic fundamental physics to most advanced practical approach. I have a short question. Could you please comment on the application facet of your multilateral work in links to clinical practice? How close are you to this application? Thank you.
Thank you, Vladimir, for your very important question. But unfortunately, I should answer that the difficult to say about the certain time of application this technique exactly in clinics. Of course, we can try to apply this technique, for example, for water cleaning technology. But as for the treatment, for example, cancer or some infection disease, there is a big problem of the general problem of introduction nanoparticles, introducing nanoparticles into the body, into the living system. There is a big doubt about the possible side effect of such introduction. Of course, with this point of view, silicon nanoparticles are most attractive because they are not only simply not toxic like noble metal nanoparticles or inert particles like aluminum silicate. Clay, but they are biodegradable. Therefore, being introduced in the body, they can be simply removed from the body technology, which can be realized with silicon nanoparticles, seems to be the most promising in the future.
Good. Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
I have a question for Victor. Can you hear me?
No questions. Okay. Thank you.
Yes, please.
Yes. In your bioimaging, it looked like you had some kind of aggregation of your silicon nanoparticles, or did you observe that, or and how did you functionalize them to make them dissolvable in water?
Mm-hmm. Of course, you're absolutely right. There is a problem of aggregation. In order to prevent this aggregation, we use several approaches. Initially, prepared laser-ablated nanoparticles were not strongly aggregated because they already charged during preparation method. As for the porous silicon nanoparticles, you can see here the aggregation was significantly suppressed, for example, when we used dextran coating. We simply store use storage of nanoparticles in dextran solution, some treatment, mechanical ultrasound. And due to such treatment, nanoparticles were well separated, were prevented for aggregation and dissolution, fast dissolution. This is crucial, because nanoparticles have two big problems. They can aggregate with time, and they can be dissolved with time. In order to prevent the both undesirable effect for bioimaging, the surface should be coated by dextran or polyethylene glycol PEG, and it significantly improve the dispersion of nanoparticles.
Okay,
you're right.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. So, unfortunately, I don't see the symbols of your questions, raise hands. And so if somebody wants to ask, please ask directly. Don't wait for my invitation. Nobody. Okay, Professor Timoshenko, thank you very much indeed. So this is the title of my presentation that was already announced. And actually this picture, I selected it just to point out the main idea, how to get something at the surface and how to control this process and how to measure the surface. So I am from Riga Technical University, Latvia, and first I became interested in development of the publications that are dealing with nanobiomaterials. So this is the research from Scopus, and have a look. Somewhere in 2000 year, we met the increment of the annual publication. I believe that this is connected with the National Nanotechnology Initiative that was announced by the President Clinton. So next, somewhere in 2000-2015, the situation became stagnated, and now we have the very renaissance jump up. And so to my mind, it is a really right time for our conference. So when we are speaking about the cells, to bring it at the surface of biomaterial, the main idea is, so the main target is to make the life of the cell at the biomaterial surface rather comfortable. And how to do this? First, I actually would like to speak about the general approach to the adhesion of the particles that we definitely know very well. This approach was developed by Nobel Prize winner Landau and his PhD student Dirigin. And the idea of this approach is, again, very simple. There are two forces, the attractive force, they're trying to get the particle to the surface. And this is the repulsive forces too. So the energy, interaction energy that delivers for the attractive force is like this one dotted line. And the repulsive force has an electrostatic nature. And the potential energy for these forces is like this. When these two potential energy come together, and if the minimum of the summarized potential energy is located very close to the surface, the particle is able to adhere. However, the distance when the attractive force does work is approximately connected with the -7 power. In opposite, the electrostatic force works at the -2 power distance. So this means that the electrostatic force really has some advantage to control adhesion of the particles at the long distance. So this is the reason that the substrate surface may be charged or delivered with a deposited charge to control the attraction or adhesion process of the particles to the surface, for instance, the cell. And so this is the result that demonstrates that really the negative charge of the surface, of the substrate surface, of the hydroxyapatite, not surface, works positively in means to get more cells at the surface. So now, how to measure this charge? And definitely, when we're dealing with biomaterial, we are very keen to don't damage this material, because at the next step, we go to immobilize the cell. That is why the very important demand to measure the electrical charge is to employ the contactless management technique. And now I speak about the possible approach that we are doing in our lab for a long of time. So we are applying the near threshold for the electron emission. And so this is the electron that is localized somewhere in the surface layer. And because of the photon excitation, the electron leaves And so we have the classical or the conventional photoelectron emission. So this is the electron function, the barrier that the electron needs to overcome to emit. And the emission current is directly proportional to some coefficient. And so energy of the photon minus the electron function. And this is the power index M that typically is more than U. So that is why this electron function value directly connects to the surface electrical charge. And that is why if you measure this one, we are able to identify the electrical surface charge deposited on biomaterial. Moreover, because this coefficient, this index is larger than unit, so this value, any variation of this value, are amplified by this index and are displayed in the emission current. So that is why if you go to measure this emission current, we have amplification of the electron function reflected here. So to measure the emission current, the technique is very simple. We need to vary the photon energy and to find the photon energy when the emission current is equal to zero. So this is the electron function. So what is important for the wide range of the material? The electron function varies from approximately 0.5 to 5 eV. This means that the mean free path of the electron is around from 10 to maybe a couple of hundred of nanometers. So this is the reason that the near threshold photoelectron emission, if you work with the photon energy close to the electron function, gives information about the nano layer. That is attractive when we're working with nanostructured biomaterials, etc. The measurement scheme is also very simple and generally known. The specimen must be delivered with a photon radiation using some illuminator and molecular system. So the emission current must be detected by some detector. Definitely the measurements are delivered in the vacuum conditions. So better vacuum, more precise measurements, definitely. Sometimes we are able to use not so high vacuum, 10 minus C state Pascal. So this is a typical device to measure. And so now the example of the hydroxyapatite surface that can be engineered just because of the restructuring of the ionic components of this material. So the idea is based on the surface tension dependence on the radius of the particle. If the radius is less, we know that the surface tension increases, and because of this, the ions that are located at the surface may be influenced and may be redistributed. So this is a computing simulation by Professor Bistrov from Russia for the large cluster of the hydroxyapatite particle and for the very, very small cluster. And you see the structure is really completely different for the particle when the radius is very small. In particular, this brown red dots, they mean this proton. So in very, very small particle, the proton density at the surface is tremendously high against the large cluster. This means that for the nanoparticles, the surface is charged positively. So this is a physical experiment that works in evidence of the theoretical calculations. So this is the dimension of the nanoparticle, and this is the electron function, actually the negative charge of the surface. Larger particle, larger negative charge. We have used this result for sintering of the artificial nanostructured hydroxyapatite. We have selected the range of the hydroxyapatite nanoparticles in the natural bone and decided that for this range of the dimensions of the particles, we need to deliver such an electrical potential of the surface. And so the ceramics became sintered, and next we had adjusted the electrical charge using doping by different atoms with the idea to substitute calcium within the crystalline lattice. And really, because of the covalent radius difference in between the dopant and the calcium, the electrical potential may be very nice engineering. So the next approach is based on the crystalline structure of the hydroxyapatite. So this is the proton that we have here, and this is the oxygen that we have here. Again, the simulation by Professor Bistrov and co-workers demonstrates that the proton has a potential minimum in the vicinity of the oxygen. Moreover, there are two symmetrical minima. And the proton may be very easily moved from one to the other one because the barrier here is not so high, 0.5, 0.1, 0.2 eV. So that is why this result opens the technological approach to move this proton from the surface into the bulk. For this, we have used a high pressure of hydrogen outside of the hydroxyapatite material. And because of this very high pressure of hydrogen outside, the hydrogen inside became at the very high gradient concentration of the protons and became moved inside. So, like this one. As a result, the surface became charged negatively, and this was tested both by direct measurements, but moreover, because of the response by biological object. So this is the cells, the osteoblastic cells, the bone developing cells that became attached to the surface of the hydroxyapatite material because of different electron work function of the surface. So more negative charge, more osteoblastic cells became attached. So this was verified with the animals, and it was discovered that the developing rate of bone tissue increased too. So the next one, the same idea that the radius is able to engineer the electrical charge wasn't used to provide the specific morphology of the surface. So for the very small radius, the surface must be charged negatively. For the very large surface, must be charged positively. For the very large radius, the surface must be charged negatively. So this is the real profile of the surface at the micro scale, micro nano scale, provided because of the atomic force microscopy. At the same time, we have measured it at this location, the electrical potential, and connected the electrical potential with the cavity of the surface. So actually with this coefficient and the parabolical approximation. So this is the potential and this is the sharpness of the peak. So there is some correlation that really demonstrates that the surface morphology has strong influence on its electrical potential. So now, if you have, for instance, the material like semiconductor, the electron function, photoelectric electron function, is measured from the top of the valence band. In this case, the electron function is contributed with the energy gap. And to identify the energy gap also is very important to know what is the electron function composed of. To use this one, we have applied this called dual electron emission. So this is a photon that excites the electron from the valence band to the vacuum. And we have applied one more photon, infrared photon, to excite the electron and hole. And because of this, the charge migrated to the surface and the Fermi level that is pinned in the surface as it is known for the semiconductors is equalized to the bulk Fermi level, and the surface bends became straight. As a result, the electron function is changed. So, in fact, the photoelectron emission current is changed too. So that is why it's possible to measure the energy gap, the surface electrical potential, and relaxation of the surface charge because of the photon excitation. The experiment is also very simple. We need to deliver both the photoelectron emission mode and the infrared photons to bring the band straight. So for instance, this is the energy before the energy gap. Nothing is happening with the photoelectron emission current. Next, the energy is increased, and for instance, the current is falling down if the energy, if the photoelectron emission current, the photoelectron emission barrier increases. So if the energy of this infrared photon is very high, we are coming to the conventional photoelectron emission barrier. So this is the example when the cadmium telluride energy gap became identified for some nanofilm. And this is the example when energy gap with the localized states of the bone was identified, and we can conclude that the bone is a really semiconductor. Moreover, we have measured the relaxation of the charge of this surface charge of this bone by the same technique, and concluded that the relaxation time is roughly 30 minutes. That is very convenient to apply the photonic excitation of the charge with the idea to treat the bone. So we have applied different photons to excite electrons from different local states, and by this way to change the electrical charge of the bone surface. The experiment was provided with rabbits. We have delivered the holes in the jaw of the rabbits and radiated them with the photons and tested the healing process of the bone because of sonography. And so this is independence of the wavelength that excited the electron holes within the bone. This is the rate of healing, actually development of the new bone. So if the energy of the photon isn't high, we excited these electrons. And if the energy of the photon is higher, so we excited these electrons. And so this is the rate, the relation of the rate with the energy of the photon. So moreover, we measured it as the electrical potential of the bone because of this excitation. This is the direction of increment of the positive positive potential that actually the osteoblastic cells that are responsible for repairing of the bone don't like this one potential. They like the negative one. So that is why the rate of bone repairing became down. So when we're working with the emission from the local level, if this level relaxes because, for instance, of temperature, we don't have any emission. So that is why if we are going to apply the temperature, we can reach zero emission because of the relaxation of the local state. So this is so-called exoelectron emission mode. So this is a specimen that is delivered with the photon to excite photo emission from the local state. And this is a heat source to heat it with the idea to relax, to anneal this local state. So this is a classical formula for photo emission. And because of heat, each element of this formula connects to temperature. Today, we know that the emission current in this case has the maximum. And the total emitted charge, this one, is directly proportional to the local states that are annealed because of heat. For instance, the simplest model of this exo-emission mode is the following one. So the electrons are located at the local state. We deliver the heat. emission, like the thermoionic emission from the local states, more temperature, more emission. So we have this branch. Next, more temperature, we don't have electrons anymore. This means that emission current must fall down. We have from the so this is the result when we applied this measurement to identify damage of the bone under gamma radiation. So the next example, when the X-ray emission mode became employed to identify phase transition of nanofilms, this is a PVDF film. This is a molecular structure of this film. It is very nice structured because on one side we have the positively charged protons, on the other side fluors, the negatively charged fluors. If this film is deposited on the surface, nanofilm, so it is definitely polarized. Moreover, this polarization may be adjusted if the substrate, the dielectric substrate, is delivered to the electrical charge, for instance, because of the ultraviolet radiation. So the polarization became stronger. And if we go, for instance, to heat this specimen, the polarization may be destroyed. And for instance, this red line demonstrates the changes or alteration of the polarization of the film, measured because of the X-ray emission for the specimen that had some imperfection. So this line, this diagram has been processed to identify the electron function in the model of thermoionic emission for this branch and for this branch. So, and the difference between these two work functions, if it is a depolarization, electrical depolarization reason, the difference must be equal to the electrical polarization field within this nanofilm. So we have calculated it, and it was became in a very well accordance with the film, with the electrical field that became calculated theoretically for this molecule. So this approach may be applied for measurement of some defects that are induced because of radiation. So now I'll tell you about some, to my mind, very important problem, nanodosimetry. So this is a DNA molecular. When radiation comes to this molecular, so this area by single particle is damaged or destroyed. Actually, this dimensional scale is approximately 2 nanometers. And it's very important to know what is the dose absorbed by this single unit of DNA. However, when we go to measure, we apply the very large detector. And the detector that measures the dose covers actually the very wide area that is much more larger that this nano object that we need to measure. So from this point of view, the detector must be very similar sized to the nano object dimension, like this one. So because of the nanofilm, PVDF nanofilm has the nano dimension, we have employed this nanofilm as a detector of radiation to identify radiation absorbed by nanoobjects. So this is a film PVDF again, and we provided radiation to this film and measured the X-ray emission response. So this is X-ray emission response independent on the radiation exposure. So we have some more or less good correlation, and we are happy with this to say, yeah, we are perhaps at the right way to meet the nano. So definitely everything that had been told to you became achieved because of the very hard job by my team, and that is why I'm very thankful to my coworkers. Some of them passed away. So my teacher, Professor Sagalovich, unfortunately. So my former students and current students, they're collaborators from abroad, from different countries, very successful and very friendly collaboration. I'm really very happy with this. So, and now it is time of the conclusion, and really I don't know what to say, perhaps this one. So, thank you very much for attention.
Hello to everybody again. Nice to see you online, but I prefer to meet you all at the real conference in Chisinau and to discuss always like we are doing in the framework of the International Conference on Nanotechnologies and Biomedical Engineering. So we are still all real people. So first of all, I would like to thank the organizers, but most important is to congratulate them, Professor Shontia and Professor Tiginiano, academician, with excellent organized conference. I attended really almost all sections and all presentations were of high quality and all professors showed really interesting results. So this means these two professors, they really devoted themselves to organize this conference, the fifth one, but the first one was here in 2011, and we can see Professor Shontia organizing first conference together with Professor Tiginiano, and of course, most important or the main results of such conferences are meeting other people. So meeting other people. During this conference, for example, I just met shortly Professor Radelung, which changed really a lot of things in my life, for example. But I want to say that Professor Shontia was the person who invited me at the Technical University and convinced me not to go to work in industry, but to stay at the department. And next academician Tiginiano also directed my life, so he convinced me to go even further with research, not to stay only with PhD, but to go with habilitation, to accept some positions at different universities around the world. Even if I had already a good offer from other countries, from the US, for example, I was spending half of the year always there. Also, these two professors, they really influenced positively my life, for example, and not only mine, but for a lot of young people who decided to devote themselves to science. Of course, we have to acknowledge the organizing committee of this conference, so was the chief professor, associate professor Raelian, with his team, they did really a nice and the hard work to make it possible to have this first conference online. And it was really, it's excellently organized, in my opinion. How these two professors changed my life, so you can see it here. So I decided to continue in science, and I liked it. Started to write a lot of papers, receiving a lot of citations. And even if you will go to Web of Science, you will see a sign here where it is marked highly cited. So not so many researchers can do it, but we can do it. Main fields are indicated, for example, on Google Scholar, on my page, or on Web of Science. Now Scopus also is pointing which directions are doing any researchers. So this is important for the young people. I suppose now are listening a lot of our students also, so they can see an example how they have to listen to professors, not just to go somewhere to work in some companies for a little bit of more money, but you can do a lot of changes in your life and help also your country. So, also by hard work and in collaborations with these two professors, I came and the top 1% by citations for 2018 and cross field. It was generated for the first time also. Received laureate of a national prize from the government of the Republic of Moldova. And where are you getting so much inspirations and so on? Not only in the lab. I spent a lot of time, so my postdoc was in Paris and at the University of Central Florida in the USA. So you know that in Paris really exists a lot of museums. So I spent, for a curiosity, I spent more than three complete weeks in my life in these museums. So you know, but in Paris exists this, the largest museum called Louvre, also Orsay. They are so beautiful, so nice. So I spend an entire day, or at least one day per month, in these museums and admiring all things done by our previous generations. And after this, for example, you can do your work in the lab much more easily. For example, first paper in advanced materials, you know, it's really hard to go in this journal, but I wrote it in 2 or 3 days. And it was accepted in 2 or 3 weeks in this journal. And now it came to highly cited, so it contributed to this. Other works also with our universities helped here. So where I am now? Now I am at the Department of Microelectronics and Biomedical Engineering, Faculty of Computer Informatics and Microelectronics at the Technical University of Moldova. So strong collaborations and everyday connection with different universities in Germany, USA, France, England, Russian Academy of Science, Ukraine, Romania, and so on, many one. And why we are microelectronics and biomedical engineering? So our main specialty, or our main program at the department, microelectronics and nanotechnologies now, it was microelectronics and semiconductor devices, which I graduated. And that's why, because of microelectronics, we can speak now online. If no microelectronics, we could not do nothing now. Also, this microelectronics affects and really change the applied electronics currently. So that's why we received at our department a new program, Applied Electronics, which is totally different. So we are training young people how to make it. And we have very good professors, young professors now in this field. And the most important is biomedical engineering, which was developed or was promoted by the professor Shontia at the Technical University of Moldova and our department. He was, and he is the head of this program. Also, biomedical engineering is not possible without microelectronics and even information technologies and other things. So that's why we have to be all together and to do hard work and research and science at the Technical University. So Technical University is the only one high educational institution accredited by the government, by the Republic of Moldova. Is something like Ecole Polytechnique. And everybody knows that Ecole Polytechnique is the most powerful, how to say, university or institutes around the world. You saw in my affiliations also University of Central Florida and our university. So I am courtesy appointment professor at the University of Central Florida, elected by, for 5 years, invited professor at the UCL University, number one in France, invited professor and scientist at the Kiel University. At the CNRS, we are inviting once per year, once or two times also, as an expert at the European Science Foundation. Our department had some history. I will not stop too long, but started from the industrial electronics department, then it formed the second department, physics of materials and semiconductor devices. Next came to department of microelectronics and semiconductor devices by combining these two departments, and currently its Department of Microelectronics and Biomedical Engineering. It was changed. Professor Schonte did it. Here are department chairs of all this. So I started, for example, somewhere here when Professor Chisinau was the department chair. Also, he was my scientific advisor for the PhD thesis. And next, the department chair for this period was Professor Schonte. These two professors also really changed and formed my character. Maybe somebody don't like it, but I'm like them. So this is life. Which programs we are covering and how many professors we have at the department? We have about 36 employees, so around 10 associate professors, 10 professors, 3 academicians, and offering programs for microelectronics, nanotechnology, biomedical engineering for the bachelor, the same for the master studies, and for PhD, we can offer to everybody who are interested 5 different specialties or 5 different profiles in applied physics. We have physics and technology of materials, physics of nanosystems and nanotechnologies. We have nano microelectronics and optoelectronics. This is more related to engineering, and other 2 specialties. We have a series of labs at the department, and of course Professor Schonte contributed a lot with his team to develop 4 new laboratories. And of course, research centers. So at the department, we have also 3 centers associated. Here some images of real life. So this was real only 2 years ago. So you can see that people know masks. We can sit together, they can organize nice conferences. So it was real. And Professor Schonte was always in, and it is always the heart of our department. And not only department, but you can see the entire faculty is attached to him and is learning from his activities and from his behavior, everything what is positively. And I really learned from this Professor Schonte, Professor Tiginiano, and my colleagues a lot in my life. So let's go back now to the research, what we are doing. So this year I selected this new topic about 3D printed sensors of nanostructured semiconducting oxides. Previously, I was showing you results about our nanosensors mainly. So, but I will do it next time at the next edition of the international conference. Main contributors or the main teams are our team from Moldova and the team of Professor Adelung from Kiel University and postdoc Leonard Siebe. Of course, our team. So short introduction, manufacturing first principles, new approaches, I will show you shortly, integration of nanomaterials and printed sensors, performances, and short conclusion of our research. Why we are studying so many things? Why? Because the detection of biological and chemical species is central to many different fields of indoor or outdoor safety. Also for healthcare is very important. For diagnostics is very important. Where I use sensors everywhere, for positioning, for proximity, for presence, you need it, for motion, for velocity, for temperature detection and monitoring, for humidity, for acoustic or sound or different vibrations. We also need sensors, chemical detection, gas sensing, flow, force, flow, leaks or levels. This is really very important. Electrical, magnetic, and accelerometer, and a lot of our daily life require different high quality sensors. And since we are at the conference, it's really important to mention that sensors are very, very important for biomedical engineering because, for example, physician or caregiver, they want to monitor patient health situation, what's it. So they are placing different types of these sensors, which can communicate. So in this case, we need a sensor node. So already with electronics here should be, and with a high quality electronics, not only sensor, which can communicate with networks to send all this information to healthcare server, and it go or to physician or to caregiver, or if something emergency, then it goes to emergency centers. Also, it is very important for researchers, for medical researchers, and everything can has to go back with a bio feedback. So sensors are important, but how to make them? We develop different approaches, different nanotechnologies, nanosensors, and so on. But always the problem is cost, or before implementation, before applying all this in industry, it's important cost per part. If you make some really easy shape or easy or easy complex geometry of the sensors, then cost is still low. But if complexity goes high, then complexity is increasing, the price goes higher and higher. And in this way, it is important to develop new approaches. So one of this is additive. So for example, with additive, you can construct different types, different shapes of these sensors. And in this case, we can see a lowering in the cost per part. Next, if you go even to more complex devices already, then it can go even to some barrier, but we can overcome this by developing something new. So by applying self-organization. So now you can solve self-assemblies, and other approaches are used, technological approaches are used to develop new devices. So what, how to make it, or how to make it? It's, for example, create some nucleation points, then you can make some inhibition zone, create more of them, inhibit, and this way can be constructed different shape and at a really low cost per part devices, including sensors. So we can see here. By combining these complex applications, we can develop 3D printing. So we can see the same nanowires, which I used previously, for example, in single nanowire nanosensors. Here we're trying to reduce the price of the device or cost of one device, and more details about this can be found in our recent works with Dr. Ziebert and Professor Adelung in nanoenergy about additive manufacturing. So for example, if we have some undefined mixture of gases, for example, then what's hazard and hazard concentrations and so on, how it can be identified. It can be printed, for example, different types of sensors arrays. Sensor one, material two, and so on. We have a lot of PhD students, and everyone is working with different materials. So it can be developed something like an array. You can make, for example, for only one compound. So it will work something like a fingerprint for one type of gas, one type of compound, or second one, if you combine, then you can make a device and a device for many different types. How it looks is first 3D printed, and our work, they are looking something like we pick it up some microparticles metal. Microparticles, first, the easiest one was the copper with diameters 1 to 10 micrometers. Then Leo was working really a lot on this topic. He developed this 3D printer for this type, and it was possible to realize by exchanging ideas, we made it. So how it can be controlled? Yes, it can be controlled by knowing these technological parameters. So for example, you can change the pressure here. You can change the diameters of these particles. You need a special diameter or radius of this syringe, and Also, it is a dependence between the flux of this microparticles flow and pressure and diameter. So these are equations Leo presented in his PhD thesis and some of joint papers. So, for example, small radius is good for higher resolution if you want to print something higher, that is to prevent the mixing particles, higher pressure, delta P is necessarily, and so on. So in this way, can be printed, for example, different types of different diameters, different shapes, and so on of material. So here, for example, we have some zinc oxide. Next, after printing, we are printing only metal particles by using some previously developed technological approaches for oxidizing these particles. We found that annealing at 400 can create such types of bridging between nanoparticles, so a really tiny nanowires, which are interpenetrated, so create a current flow through this network. So in this way, by combining these two techniques, additive manufacturing, self-organizations, we made first device. Also, Leo and his team and their group of Professor Adelung are working on different types of other materials, for example, zinc oxide. Zinc oxide for UV sensors, CNTs, it can be used for the conductor. Copper we published for gas sensing, mixing copper and iron for gas sensing. Also can be printed iron for magnets and so on. Any ideas can be now explored and reported. Of course, first devices printed show some response, but we are always proposing some mechanism which explain why this is good. So these types of sensors were good for acetone. So here was also our PhD students, Nikolai and Nikolai. So we observed that at different operating temperatures, we can control the gas response. For example, at 300 is the lowest, but if we go to 350 already, it shows that sensor behavior by increasing it in the even higher response of this devices. CNTs can be printed, we explained, and by combining with zinc oxide, it can be made some UV sensors, and it can be flexible. So this way it can be printed. If you need more details about this, you can find the nanoenergy, also nanoenergy. This is our printer, a lot of websites, and even Ministry of Research of Germany, they published our photo and our results about this research. But we moved forward with this technique. So now we are trying to develop some sensors for battery. Now you know that everybody is moving to electrical cars, but these cars have huge batteries. And if some leakage of gases or something, it can be really catastrophic. So that's why it's important. Here we published some recent results with our group in Moldova and group of professors here. Invited paper. But next, of course, we are doing all characterizations. I will not stop at each one. Of course, we need to do XRD, we need to do Raman, we need to do XPS to identify which crystal phases we have, how we can control the properties of these devices, and so on. So all this is done and explained. Time I will stop. So, of course, we studied a mixture with different gases and we found the most selective to acetone. Why acetone? Acetone is important for diabetic monitoring. So if we can really produce such types of sensors and to make it even much more selective, then by integrated an electronic node, we have our young PhD students coming soon. They will try to implement these electronic nodes and include sensors, and we next can monitor, if, for example, in hospitals, so on. Because different professors from different countries, they already asked, can we study this? I have permission, and so on. So this is our next target. for application, another approach of the same techniques. We used copper oxide with iron oxide. So this one is a p-type semiconducting oxide, p-type behavior. This one is p-type, this one is n-type. In this case, we have PN, combination of PN materials, which helped us to reduce the power consumption, because if we want to implement such types of sensors in an electronic node and monitor something continuously, then it's much better to have the lowest power consumption. And this way, it can work longer with the same battery, but also and help monitoring of the person. Here you can see some examples how we made first devices. So we, if somebody will decide or some companies will decide to use it, we have it developed so we can make a really big production of such types of sensors. Also, we observed that such types can be even suspended, flexible, 3D printed copper iron sensor. So you can see, even if we have nanowires, they are really hard, strong materials. You see, few nanowires can hold microparticles of this metal. So we can create this flexible. Research on this is in progress. We already have some results. So devices are working. Also depends on the extension. So all experiments are done, but it will be reported later. As I mentioned, we did all characterizations for these materials, copper, iron mixture, and so on. We identified all crystal phases and also even some metal traces in these materials. Detailed analysis by TM was done, confirming observations from the XRD purity of this, because it's important to study the surface of these materials after printing, if we don't have some other traces, and it found on the copper iron. Here more performances of these sensors, copper iron mixture, 3D printed. Also, this type of devices showed a good selectivity to acetone vapors, but we can see here saturation after high concentrations, so higher than 100 ppm acetone concentrations already is saturation of this device. But we are interested, for example, for biomedical engineering, we are interested somewhere in this region. So we tested below 1 ppm, and we already observed that devices are working. With increasing concentrations, it can show an increase. These devices still more work to be done here. Also, power was reduced below 1 microwatt for such type of sensor mixing, and response was increasing. Technical characteristics and so on is property. Also, with our PhD students, we tried to make maybe even a easy way to fabricate devices. So we just picked up a single microwire of copper, placed here some copper microparticles, used the same annealing approach, and obtained something like for a shell structure, and all detailed characteristics I will not stop here. And we found that such types, for example, of sensors can work like 3-in-1. For example, at room temperature, it is a good detector of 2-propanol. If we increase temperature, for example, to 155, we can detect ethanol. But if we go to higher temperatures, then we can detect hydrogen. So, for example, such types of simple developed sensors can be used for 3-in-1. And quite stable also on time, you can see. Of course, it was proposed and published the sensing mechanism, some theoretical calculations, why it's good for ethanol, why it's good for propanol. All this was done and reported. In this part, we involved some teams from the UK, from India, from Netherlands, different groups. And if someone can and like to do this, we are really open for collaboration on this field also. If somebody can be involved in computations and to develop this new and explain new mechanism. If we compare developed sensors, they are in the same range or even much higher, much better than reported ones with most recent literature. So, in a short conclusion, we can see that sensors, if we use only copper, it's a good for hydrogen at this temperature. If we want a acetone sensors, then we have to use copper mixture with iron oxides. Copper, it's a good for acetone. If we go for room temperature with microwire, we can get 2-propanol or get sensors. So I want to say thank you to project supporting us, different projects, also to our PhD students from Moldova involved. So they are doing science, but they, even Vasily received his recent PhD, Nikolai is defended already first one at the department, but now Nikolai is the next one. And all of them received their fellowships from the government of the Republic of Moldova, excellent PhD student. As I mentioned, we are not doing only research, but also we try to implement all these devices in real ones and to make it functional. So here we have some examples of nanosensors, but we have young PhD students which are developing our electronic nodes, and we will show soon much more results. Our team, of course, Professor Shontia was always supporting us and involved in collaborations and everything with our team. Here are names I will not talk. Of course, Professor Adelung Kim. I want to mention that he has more than 20 PhD students. So it's really hard work, and more than 8 postdocs. So it's not so easy, but he can do it. He's a strong and always generating new ideas, and can guide all these young people to get a PhD. Of course, acknowledgements to Professor Kinley, Tim, Professor Howfield, Tim and others which are involved. And at the end, at this conference, we are always going to Krikova when it was a real life. Professor Shontia publishing all books on Springer, all our patients with Professor Komin. We are here at the Krikova. So if you want to know, in Moldova, we have 2 largest in the world wine cellars. One is in Krikova, and then have one is in Miller. So we have about 120 kilometers underground, and temperature is always constant. And after this conference, we are always on visit here. It's really interesting, real life. I hope we'll come back soon to real life. And I want just to say that we are now collaborating with different current countries and research groups. So of course, I hope we can cover entire with our collaboration. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much indeed for your very nice presentation, very detailed, and the finalization of your presentation with the distillers of wine. So virtually, but so we are feeling the smell. So thank you very much indeed. So now, please, our session is open for the questions. And again, it is my field. Just ask the question and feel free to ask, because I don't see everybody on my screen. Please ask the question. No questions. Okay, Professor Lupan, thank you very much indeed.